Hi everyone, good afternoon. Welcome to today's webinar, Mechanical Engineering Deep Dive. My name is Varun Heta. I'm the Fusion 360 Community Manager here at Autodesk. And thank you so much for taking time out and being here with us today. We have Sarvana, who heads Mechanical Engineering at Next Big Innovation Labs. It's a Bangalore-based company who is now taking 3D printing to the next level using technology for bioprinting human skin. Yeah. So this technology called bioprinting uses biological materials such as cells to create bio-ink that's loaded into a bioprinter. So today, Sarvana will share some key highlights about best practices of mechanical engineering, and he will also share some amazing insights of taking your mechanical designs for manufacturing. So welcome, Sarvana.
Thank you, Varun. Welcome everyone to today's webinar. Hope we all being safe and good. Let me share my screen. So today's webinar topic is about mechanical engineering deep dive. So basically myself, Sarvana, and I currently work as an engineering R&D head at Next Big Innovation Labs, Bangalore. So at NBIL, I work with interdisciplinary team to reach the vision. Mostly, I'll have to guide the team and with respect to engineering works. And I believe teamwork can bring in things from ideation, manufacturing, up to validation of the product. The product that I refer over here is a 3D bioprinter. We as a team had developed bioprinters from scratch. And also we invented few technologies as a team and received patents as well. The mission will be updated in form of versions and as well as based on the requirements. Fusion 360 is a tool which I use for concept design and also iterating it with input that I receive from the teams as well. Then, you know, the process starts after finalization, where I work closely with manufacturers in order to bring the design to reality. So on today's agenda, we'll be talking about at first the best practices that one should follow at time of designing, and then moving to the technical demonstration, finally Q&A session. So what I do, post my college, I got into a training center at Bangalore to get skilled over CAD and other few sectors. Then later ended up in a studio where I'll have to create a 3D sculpture from a normal 2D photographs. That's the time where, you know, I exposed myself to additive manufacturing. So I designed this 3D models. Later, it gets printed using 3D printer, since I am capable enough to handle design and 3D printers by my own. Later, then I got into a company as a production designer and had practiced industrial manufacturing techniques. So there I started working in assembly and testing of 3D printers, both Cartesian and Delta variants. So the picture over here says that I had worked and assembled a few machines in my previous companies, both the variants like the Prusa models, as well as the Ultimaker models, and do these Delta model printers. Now, at Next Big Innovation Labs, I work in different divisions. Being a production engineer and my 3D modeling skills made me to work on this pre-surgical models. So here I designed these models from CT scan and modified it according to the requirements. Then these files will be printed using 3D printers. I keep myself switching between softwares like Maya and MesMixture to bring out the exact requirements. These 3D models will later be used by surgeons in order to undergo required simulation works. Also, as Varun mentioned, we do had developed 3D bioprinters from scratch. As I mentioned before as well, I do work with the team and try bringing things into reality. The mission is completely designed by us using Fusion 360, and it do have a touch of generative design in it. So all over my experience on design basically it motivates me to go further and explore the possibilities which I can get into it. The tools that I prefer using all throughout is Autodesk Maya on Model and Sculpt Workspace, MesMixture for 3D modeling, and Fusion 360 from Model. So these are the environments, right? From Model up to the generative design. I just got to use all these environments in a day-to-day basis. Finally, I use Autodesk Sketchbook to capture my ideas at very initial stage. So coming back to the agenda, there are few best practices which I suggest as must doable ones as a design engineer. So starting from here, we should hear to the inputs, let it be from a team or a company or a customer or even a social problem. So then I would say one have to interact with themselves and try foreseeing the possibilities. As a design engineer, we should hear to the inputs. So that's what I said. So next is the interaction stage. So here we have to interact within ourselves and try foreseeing the possibilities. Next, try using the available resources. Let it be the educational stuffs or some new current technologies that's been evolving in the current world. Personally, I would prefer doing both the things. You know, one more thing, basically, when I'm involving myself into a project, I do work on both things. Say, starting from my educational contents, I will refer things like to a very basic level, actually, like fluid mechanics, thermodynamics, or solid mechanics, stuff like that, because it depends basically on the project that what I'm going to work on. And later, I'll see what is the current technology that's been evolving in the current market. Then I'll try to bring both the things. Say, for example, I can think about something and I wanted to manufacture it in a different way. Then I have to go and learn to the current technology. So I should adapt myself to the current scenarios. So that's a major thing. Next, now one have to learn the things. So as I mentioned before, we have to learn something in order to start or provide an idea to the product. Finally, it's time to ideate. Put all the above efforts and expose the idea. The ideas can be in any form, let it be 2D drawings or the 3D models or the CAD drawings or even a PDF will do so. Now, final stage is the pre-check. So once after creating a solution to a problem, now the designer have to go back and see whether the solution is meeting to the exact problem requirements and check whether all the parts have been narrowed down towards it. So these are the things I'll say it's a must doable ones from designers. And don't. So this I would like to say, these are my line of control, where never say no at early stage. Rather, one can try few doable things and later say the line no. Either one can go back and try things like interact within yourself, resource, try figuring out resource to the problem. Then if really we can't find any solution, then that's the stage where we should come and say no. And yeah, finally, it's saying don't be in a place where it's closed. Think you are in a place where everything is let open. Don't set any boundaries when we are working towards design. So these are few things that I basically follow in my day-to-day career protocol sort of things. Next, now it's time to get into the tech demo. On this session, the task part is going to be the portable vending machine. On your right is the conceptual design of the machine. So this machine is designed by myself using Autodesk Fusion 360. Yeah, this is an idea created to prevent us from COVID-19, which is the current pandemic, right? So we, being a designer, we had to think of something to solve, act immediately to a social problem and come up with a solution. So it actually boosted me to work on this project. Then, so its logic is so simple. It just reduces the people contact between object handling. Say, consider another scenario like this. If a person B is getting a product or a component from person A, what happens? There is a high chances of virus getting transmitted from A to B. So in order to remove that, this machine actually will do so, will do reduce on such issues. So that's an one more motivation towards working on this project. Next, being a designer, as I mentioned before, we have to show some social touch as well in order to provide solution to any such new problems. Next, moving ahead, the discussion will be in lines with three steps, from 2D sketching, 3D modeling, and generation of manufacturing data. So this is my initial step that I took towards the problem. This is a 2D sketch of the machine designed using sketchbook, again from Autodesk. So being a design engineer, I just wanted to lift my skills or update my skills to another level. So I started pursuing few design techniques academically and do receive some certifications as well. Also, a note over here, practice makes perfect, right? So which worked for me by end of 1.5 years effort. So yeah, even being a starting designer or in my fresh years, I used to think about, okay, let me work on a design process or let me design something in very quick stage. But yeah, you need to have a practice. So that's what my result used to say each and every time. So that's how I come up to a level like this. Next, I moved personally from being a traditional mechanical designer to an industrial designer. I'll tell you the reason why, because as a designer, if I'm designing a product or working on some project, what happens is I'll meet the problem, say something has to move to a certain limit or something like that. I'll meet the requirements, but I felt somewhere I'm missing, say the product designers or industrial designers, they generally used to work on the shapes. So the products that we see all over us, even the mouse or the car, gets our attractions, right? So that's what made me to set that as a goal and proceed further. So here I tend to use vacuum tablets for sketching this similar products. Basically, I started developing this idea or concept from basic cube that you see over top left. Then it's a stage to think about the internal components. I do had thought about little aesthetic, so I did a mild aesthetic touch in the machine as well. Then at initial stages, the design will not be perfect. So that's what everyone knows, right? So in the 2D drawing phase or creating an ideation phase, so there is no perfectness required. Then later, I just went to explain things using this process in the drawing by itself. So the drawing, there's a say, right? The drawings have to say what it meant to be. So that's a logic that's been followed by few product designers. So yeah, I had to start following those things. Also, as I mentioned before, this is one in many ways to capture an idea. Next, quickly moving into a 3D model. The topics that we'll be discussing is in lines with the frame selection, sheet metal, assembly design, sub-assembly, process plan, which is creating a manufacturing data. Before getting into the live CAD demo, I would like to clarify a few key terminologies, you know, which I would prefer to say as a takeaway from this webinar. One should know the operations involved in sheet metal works before initiating design process. Cutting and forming are very two basic operations where the idea gets sculpted to reality. One should at least know 2 to 3 process in each of these operations. Next, talking about minimum requirements. I feel these two plays a vital role at times of fabrication. One, the flange length. It's nothing but, in simple term, it's a flatness that's that's required after a bend. So one should consider the minimum flange length before designing a sheet metal product. Other one is the hole or slot distance. Yeah, again, I'm putting it down in the simple terms. It's like the lower, the closer the hole to the edge of the sheet metal, the weaker the product or the weaker the component will be. So that's one fact that I used to keep in my mind at time of working with the sheet metal developments. Then also to, I had added one more thing. In order to know about tolerances, one can refer this ISO 27681 standards, where it talks about the standards, the minimum requirements for a hole or a slot and much more things, even a radius. So things like that, it's been said already over there. Next, the bend tolerance. This refers to the expansion in length of sheet metal due to plasticity. So in simple, the length of the sheet metal will differ when it's flat and after undergoing forming process, because the bent portion will show some plasticity in it. So the basically metals do have plasticity and elasticity properties in it. So that's the reason why there is a change in length of the sheet metal post bending. Next, the K factor, something preferably used in CAD softwares to fix a neutral axis. So this is something I would say most of the CAD softwares use it, which is a factor. You can say the neutral axis can be predicted from the overall thickness of the sheet metal. If the sheet metal is going to be 1 mm, then the neutral axis will be at 0.5 mm length in the point. Finally, the part joining methods. One should know actually what the part joining method he or she is planning to put onto the products. Like it can be a rivet or a screw or the welding process, any of the welding process. So all these things should be considered at time of starting your design process, particularly in sheet metal. So let me give you a real time example of this part joining methods. The reverts, basically we'll be using reverts in automobile bodies like bus or cars, or even in the aircrafts you can see there are a lot of reverts. The reason why they use reverts is because it's a one-time assembled body and they are not going to reopen it again. If they are going to reopen it, it's going to be almost 15 to 20 years of time they'll be reopening and changing the body works, things like that. But when it comes to a machine design or a product design, it's not the same case. The maintenance people need to operate the machine, so they need to get access in a multiple direction. So thinking all that in mind, one has to design a machine or a product so that it's a better way of choosing the things, right? Now quickly, we dive into Fusion 360 workspace to discuss few considerations regarding the bending machine. So on the screen, it's a vending machine that's been designed using Fusion 360, I was showing before. First, I'll start up with a roundup view. So if you see, this is the right side and the back side of the machine. So here I do have provided a door. The reason is to get access to the machines, right? As I mentioned before, starting a design, we should know how are we going to access the machine in any ways. And you can see over here, there is an input supply. So through this, the user can directly give a supply to the machine and the machine goes on. So this is the left side. So the left and right remain same and the front panels. So what happens here is, so let me tell you one thing. Here I should consider, so it's like it's almost like a traditional vending machine, but one quick change is it's a portable one. So considering the overall dimension as my constraint, I had worked on it. And yeah, this is a top-down assembly. And yeah, I do had did some mixture of bottom-up assembly as well into this models. Say the user comes in and they presses randomly some button over here. So each button refers to the rack of the conveyor belt system. And over here, after pressing the button, over here, the user had to insert the money. What happens is the conveyor the axis goes up. There are two axes. I will just show you, give a brief about this entire working in this model. Next, I will show you in the exploded design. So what happens is, after inserting the money, the entire collector plate will move to the pickup point. Let it be in the first stack or let it be in the second stack. It goes up there, comes down back, and it will be dropping the product into the collector plate. And the user can just take out the product and use it. So this is so simple, right? The concept. And yeah, and I haven't made a complete assembly design. The reason why I haven't done so is, basically, you know, when I'm starting a design, I probably approach the top-down design. But what happens is, since it's in a conceptual stage, I'll need to change multiple things. Say I might need to change in water or the collector bin size based upon the product. So things like that will keep coming when the product is in a development stage. So that's why I just, for this session, I just made an manufacturer ready file for the sheet that's been there on this right side. I'll talk about it in this exploded view. So over here, if you see, so this is the complete exploded view of the machine. As I said before, let us start. We'll go step by step. We'll start from frame selection. I'll talk about why I selected this frame. Then we'll move on to the sub assembly parts and sub assembly parts. Also, a bit about the mechanisms. And finally, coming back to the sheet metal part. So, the frame that I chose over here is a 10 by 10 aluminium frame. So there are multiple reasons why I chose this frame rather going with the extruder aluminium frame or the profile, something like that. The reason why I chose is, since it's going to be a portable vending machine, so that's needed to be highlighted in multiple places. Since it's going to be a portable vending machine, what I thought is to keep the design so tight, the components in a tight space, it has to get fit with multiple axes and the multiple sites. So multiple operations are also needed to be involved in this manufacturing process. So what happened is, that's the reason, one among the reasons why I chose this 10 by 10 frame. So basically, if you see over here, this is my right side of the machine. So here I do provided the holes for assembling my the outer enclosure or the outer sheet metal. We can say this is a chassis mode or something like that. And now coming into the pillar frames. So pillar frames, basically what it does is, it just holds the components. Say let it be the sheet metal. For now it looks like a sheet metal over here, but what happens over here is, this on top of the sheet metal, these three conveyor belt systems are going to sit, so which needs a support, right? So that's where it needs to be mounted onto the pillar frame. So if you see over here, there is a flange that's being made. So the thing is, as I mentioned before, it's not completely assembled design. So I haven't made any such holes for now. So there will be a hole over here, which the designer or engineer can directly fix the component into the pillar frame. So yeah, now there comes a questions, or we might think, right, why I chose go with this pillar frame and the mainframe stuffs and all. So if you see, basically I actually get attracted to this automobile things and all. What happens is that they do have the pillar frames, ribs, struts, things like that, in order to hold the body to keep in that shape. And it provides the enough strength to the whatever the machine. So that's where one of the approach I used to do. I used to take the approaches like things in this phase. So that's one reason why I chose this, to go with the pillar frame and the mainframe context. Now, coming into the assembly part. So over here, this machine generally works. I think most of us had worked with 3D printers, so I went with that such concept. So this machine basically works in two axes. Yeah, we can say it as a 2D printer system. So what happens over here is, I just chose Z and X axis. So I do use a stepper motor for my considerations. So which moves, the Z axis stepper motors moves up and down, which makes this connector plate to go to a certain position and pick the product. And yeah, then I thought, okay, I need a motor or my collector plate need to move towards X axis. The reason is I had stacked and grouped the six conveyor belt system into this machine. So my point is like the plate has to go to all six points. It should be reachable to all six collecting places. So that's where I thought, let me use on the motor for towards X axis. So that's how this concept come in. Next, if you see in this collector plate, it's like a cam sort of thing. So what happens is here I had fixed a servo motor. Let me show that in the back side. So here I had used a servo motor, which is a continuous rotating servo motor. And again, when it comes to electronics, it's a different procedure one has to follow while considering the components as well. So what happens over here is, since this is a continuous rotating servo motor, think a motor in a home that rotates continuously to pump the water. So what it does is, I don't want it to rotate continuously. So when something is open, I can set a limit to it, right? So when it rotates, say for example, 90 degree anti-clockwise, what happens is the plate, the collector plate will tend to face forward towards the collector pin. So that's where I thought, okay, the motors will do the job right now. And when it rotates 90 degree clockwise, it just collects up some parts. And yeah, there is one more thing, like why did I choose something, say, I would have gone with the normal flat plate, right? Instead of choosing something like in a curvy shape, something like. So take this as an example. When we are about to get something from someone, just see how our hands are acting. It used to tend or it used to bend to a certain degrees, right? Not knowing ourselves. The reason is the product that we are getting in our hands should not fill up. So similarly, the same concept comes in here. I had used a flat plate, there is a high chances of product falling down accidentally inside the machine itself rather than coming into the collector bin. So that's where I thought, okay, so let me use this as an thing and design a plate to collect some items. So now it will fall into it, then it stays in that place. Now just it has to rotate or tilt to a certain angle, then drop in the components into the collector bins. So that's how it works. Next comes the conveyor belt system. So here I have a conveyor belt system exploded view in a different file. I'll talk about it in a bit. Now coming to the sheet metal part. So here if you see, the sheet metal is bent outwards, which is 45 degree. So let me put it in a side view. So if you see over here, the sheet metal is being bent towards an angle. So if you see from side, it do says that from here to here, there is something. It looks like a solid body if you see from front, but that's not the case. If you see it from side, it's a sheet metal. Now I'll talk a bit about this. Let me just isolate this part. I do think people know this, like isolating a single component into the workspace. If you are working on top-down design, this tool helps me a lot actually. Rather than extracting this file outside and putting it in some new other file and working on it. Okay. Now, let us talk in straight. So over here, if you see over here, I'm planning to use something. So most of the people would know I had planned to use a countersink hole. Screws. So that's what I had planned. So here my power joining method is screw based ones. And the other thing, if you see closely, I had extruded only this part, only this side a little bit. And why not on this side? So I'll tell you why I had did that. The reason is, see, basically at time of assembling a machine or something, there comes a confusion. Only the people like engineer or the assembling people will come to know, like they'll get a confusion, right? Which side of the sheet metal should face them or face back or face top or face down. So there comes a confusion when it comes to complete designing process. So to avoid that, though I had worked on it. So to avoid that, I used to follow these kind of strategies into the design. So over here, this says that, okay, something is extruded a little bit more. So this is going to be my front part, and the back part also looks similar to it. Top and down doesn't bother for me. So this is one way of approach that I used to do when making a sheet metal. So this is kind of an approach. And next is, let me make it flat. So yeah, coming back to the tools that's available in Fusion 360 is like the solid workspace, surface, sheet metal, things like that. I think there are a lot many tutorials and good stuffs available in the YouTube or the Fusion 360 websites as well. So I am not going into that deeper for now. So right now, let me make it flat. So this is an awesome tool where you can unfold something, make it in a flat pattern in a fraction of seconds. So
just a quick one. We have one question from Ms. Manideep.
Sure.
And he's asking, how can a stepper motor be directly connected to the screw rod?
Okay. So, let me take that question. So what happens is the screw rods, it's not directly connected. There are hybrid stepper motors that comes in. It's called as an hybrid linear stepper motor. So there you'll be having a screw going all through the way inside the stepper motor. So there will be a small nut inside it, which makes, so if you fix two ends of the screw rods, what happens is the motor rotates in that axis by itself. And if you can mount the motor into some components, then it actually stops the motion of the motor and it makes the center nut of the motor to rotate internally. So that's a motors or the product that's been available in market. You can use it. Yeah, no. Now coming back to the sheet metal. So here I had unfolded this entire sheet right now. So let me keep it in front. And yeah, now I think everyone can take a look at it. See, there are multiple shapes over here and the bend that is being done. So this is what the manufacturer's point of view. If I am a manufacturer, I need some data like this at first. So let me talk about all these things in the generation of manufacturing documents as well. So over here, if you see, this is the exact flat view, and you can see the point which I was saying before. I had extruded a little bit over here in this points, in these places on only front and back side. So this is what I was mentioning in a time before. So this kind of strategy that people used to work. Now coming back to the other sheet metal. So what I thought is, let me show you a small tool that makes us to create a shape like that. So go to flange, capture the portion. Now I'm just selecting all four sides of the flat sheet. So it's kind of a trick sort of thing, which we basically follow. I think most of the people knows about it, but still, let me say it out right now. Okay, now I had chosen all four sides in a plate. What happens is this arrow allows me to drag it and extract or extrude, or in this sheet metal workspace, we had to say it extends the material. So now what happens? Let me keep it to 50. Okay, now there is a small radio button over here. It says, if you go close to it, it says it shows a circle kind of thing, which is a continuous at up to 180 degree and dot at over top 180 degree. So what it says is the sheet can be made flat enough. So if you are working on flat sheet, then no use of using this tool right now. That doesn't make sense. But I'm going to do something different. So what happens is I'm going to keep it to a certain angle right now, which is 45 degree that I fixed for now. Okay. Let me click OK. Now the outward bend shape is being done in the sheet metal, which is there in my live design. Now what happens is, let me go choose this flange again, select one edge. Yes, let me keep it in a front view, or let it be in a back view. So So what happens here? Now the software says, okay, you can take a flange to with reference to the previous component. So that's where it's showing 90 degree towards it. So what happens if I extrude over here? So I had extended that part, this flange component. Now what happens here is, since my part or my frame is going to be a 10 by 10 solid frame, this is a rectangle square frame. Now what happens here is, if I have to fit the sheet metal into the frame, then my frame should be welded or joined in a diamond shaped building, like shape of a V. So what happens over here is, I can do something, because since I had kept a constraint on my design saying it's going to be a square block. So what happens over here is, see, you can see over here, there are these lines are pixelized, right? So yeah, so now it's flat enough over here. It says there is no pixelization issues. So it says that this is flat to the surface, something like that. Flat to the face of the sheet metal, flat sheet metal, which we had fixed before. So the reason why I talked about this tool is, this trick is, generally when it's a known angle, when it comes normally in this thing and we use the flange command, they extended it, we might not know, or someone might get confused saying what angle they had to keep it. They will need to do calculations in that part. So in order to avoid that, this trick actually helped me. Basically, if you say to a level, can say at a concept stage, this will help me. But when it goes to the manufacturing, yeah, I definitely recommend to go ahead with the calculation, keep a note of all things. So things like that should be followed. So yeah, so this is about, this how the flange has been created. So all four sides has been created in the same way. So this is about the entire exploded design. And yeah, when it comes to the flat shape, there's no big change, but one thing is, it's an inward bent. The flange is towards the inside portion, inside of the machine. It's facing inside. So that's one difference is that. Rest, everything, all the process remains same. So coming into the conveyor belt system. So if you see over here, I had used a servo motor. Again, this is a continuous rotation servo motor, which has been directly connected to a pulley over here. So what happens over here is, the pulley tend to drive this belt. One more thing, we need to see the tension of the belt. So at a particular tension, with variation in tensions, the belt tend to work in a different way. So that's also one consideration when you're working something like this, or the timing belts. So things like that, we need to consider. We need to have a tolerance actually in it, so that we basically, calculation works 80 to 90%, but basically the thing is, due to some tolerance in manufacturing or assembly, or due to some issues, there might it might create a little bit of little loose flexibilities, things like that will come in. So to reduce those problems, it's better to go with the belt pulleys with the tolerance in it. So what happens over here is, since, as I mentioned before, this pulley rotates towards with respect to the motor's direction, and it directly drives this belt over here. So here I had used the rollers in different forms. So if you see over here, this part, I had particularly used rollers with the bearing and the bearing mount in it. And here, this front two rollers, I haven't used such. The reason is, say for example, here in my roller, I am joining this shaft with my roller as an one-time joint. Like say I go ahead with the welding and I'll fix it together. So the reason is, I just want something to rotate with respect to the motor's pulleys without losses. So that's where I thought, yeah, there will be losses. There is a chances of losses, say 5 to 10% something in the power transmissions. So these two pulleys, when you see, these are for tensions, as I mentioned before. Having a tolerance to fix this pulleys actually will solve the flexibility issues of the belt as well. So yeah, and I do had provided to mounting holes in order to mount it directly onto the machine. So let me go into this. So if you see over here closely, right here I am mounting my conveyor belt system in an aligned manner. So yeah, so this is how my conveyor systems are going to sit. Yeah, to hide the screws or to bring in some other part joining methods. It's an approach towards the designer. Now, into the drawings. Yeah, there's an error because I did some modification in the drawing and I haven't updated over here. Yeah, because it's not a major thing. So coming into the drawing part, okay, so now I made a design. I made a sheet metal design using few development process, considering how my operation is going to be. So things like that I had done. And now it comes to the manufacturer stage. So now I know, okay, this is how my design is going to work. And even my team as well know, okay, this is how we are going to mount these components, stuff like that. Now, how will I make manufacturer understand my design? So drawing is something where I personally say it's a language between manufacturer and the designer. So where the communication happens between us. So if you see over here, as a consider me as a manufacturer, so what I would recommend or I would see at first when I'm seeing a drawing, I just need an overall length and width of a component. So that's what I'll go at first stage. Later, then comes the data like this. So over here, if you see, before bending and after bending, data is required. So in this case, from the point over here, from this line and towards the end of the flange is 50.03. But when you consider the point, the line from here to the flange length, the distance is going to be around 47.39. Yeah, typically to say after bending, the radius will get increased and the distance dimensions will be changed. But when it goes to a new manufacturer, if I'm working with an existing manufacturer, then I don't need to provide such minor data to him. But when it's a new manufacturer, then it's my duty to provide him with an data where he would require, I don't want him to call back and ask such data as well. So that's one part. Next, coming into the holes. You see over here, since it's going to be M3 mount, the screws that I use is an M3 screw, so I need a mount M3 hole over here with the head should be flat enough to the sheet metal part. So that's where I chose to have two different operations over here. So yeah, most of us would have known that the M3 screw is about 2.8 to something, and the outer dia or the countersink dia is going to be 6.3 in it. So that's a general procedure. Yeah, so let me talk about this notation a bit later. Now, coming back to the tools over here, as I mentioned before, there are lot many good tutorials or good procedures that's available to teach us how to use multiple tools using Fusion 360. Let me directly dive into the output. So same, Fusion will allow us to extract the idea into these different outputs. Say PDF drawing, DXF, or the CSV format. Let's exclude CSV for now. Let's keep in our mind that the PDF is DWG and DXF formats. So what happens is, I would say, to my strategy, I had kept and defined things like this. So PDF is nothing but which is be used in internal reference purpose. Say, for example, I'm making a machine like this. Then let it be, the first machine will be a prototype model. Later on, I need to make in a batch, say 10 number of machines. There, I need to maintain separate files for the machine internal in my office, where we'll know, okay, how many components have been done so far and what all is being left. So data like that will be recorded in file. So for that purpose, PDF is definitely useful. In the same way, manufacturer do this procedures. Say they do need to keep a file or maintain a data, right? How much they are manufacturing and how many components for each machine they had manufactured in order to do some tally related stuff. So that's where PDF plays major role. Coming into drawing file, So drawing file is nothing but a detailed reference. So one can figure out any details in using the drawing files. Say for example, as I mentioned before, okay, hey, this is an empty hole spot. And yeah, let me get into this part right now. Over here, if you see, so what it notates, if it's a new manufacturer, or to my level, what I would say is, if it's a new manufacturer, I prefer giving data like this. It says that, okay, you have to drill M3 hole first for a depth of 1.5 mm, then the process can proceed further. So what happens over here? As the manufacturer first take out the entire shape or entire important things, and he'll be cutting it using the laser cutting machine, things like that, he'll be using it. So in that stage, what he'll do is this process itself, this whole for a single countersink screw has two different processes in the manufacturing part. Say at first he'll cut an M3 hole with the full depth, which is 1.5 mm using laser cutting machine. The reason is he'll be using the entire laser cutting, entire sheet that will be cut using laser cutting machine, which is going to be 1.5 mm thick. So he might as well cut this hole through it itself. Then later on he comes back at time of forming. What he does is he'll come back to the PDF for the drawing data. Mostly he'll be referring the PDFs, so which is a file that's kept next to the workspace. So what happens over here is he'll understand that, okay, something I have to make a counter sink or I have to make a draft over here which is perpendicular to the hole, which is in the dia of M3 CSK head. Yeah, here people pretty much define what is the dia of the drill that they require to make it over there. But the thing is, at very early stage, I would say it's good to go with the notations, like say M3 CSK head, everyone knows it, right? What dia it's going to be there, things like that, rather than complexing the stuff like saying it's a 8.3 or 6.3. If the data clashes, then the manufacturer it'll lead the manufacturer into a confusion stage. So to avoid that, it's better to provide data like this in common. If you are not sure about the sizes or something like that, so that works actually. And finally, the DXF part. DXF is nothing but the design exchange files. So it carries only the required data. Say, yeah, as I mentioned before, the manufacturer just directly take this design or the sheet metal or whatever the concept into his CAD software. So what he has to do is, some might do, what they'll be doing is they'll be sitting and removing the unnecessary data, like the camper hole is not required at very early stage in order to cut or so. So what they'll be doing is they'll have to remove it manually, or yeah, there are many softwares which just removes the entire stuff and just go ahead with the laser cutting process alone. But what I would suggest is it's better to have a different drawings, say for with respect to the process. At first, if it's going to be laser cut, just go ahead with the laser cutting process. Don't give the data like the holes, like M3 head holes over here. So that is unnecessary, and even the center lines won't carry the data directly to the manufacturer. Yeah, so this is about the vending machine. Now coming back to my presentation. Yeah, so overall we are at end towards the session. The outcomes will be, I had discussed regarding few design process, key terminologies, live CAD demo, and touch on manufacturing documents as well. Now let me answer to few questions, keeping the time constraints.
Hey Sabana, thank you so much for the very insightful session. And I also see we have some amazing questions coming on.
Okay.
So right. There's the question by Azim. Is there any way to flatten conical surface like sheet metal?
Yeah, there are ways to flatten it. Actually, if you are working in a sheet metal, definitely you need a flat surface, at least say for example, at least a 2 to 5 mm or so. which helps you to flatten it out.
And Vijay wants to know, any animation have you done so far?
Yeah, I do had worked on animations, but when it comes to this design, considering the conceptual stage, I haven't worked, but the entire concept has been framed by my own internal animation, where I just frame the concept so that it moves from here, there, and picks up the stuff, things like that I had done.
Right, we have one good question. What is your workflow approach while designing a conceptual project like this? Do you apply the tolerances and refine for manufacturing before starting the design or after making a rough model?
Yeah, definitely. After making a rough model, I will be considering my tolerances rather than considering it before and remodifying it. As I mentioned before, even in this design, I haven't considered any such details. The reason is my components might change, the internal components might change based upon the application. So there, finalizing the concept, then I'll go ahead with the tolerance before the manufacturing. That's a closer step to the manufacturing.
Right. Ritvik wants to know, how much time will it take to 3D print a biological part?
It depends upon the shape again. So when it comes to 3D printing, generally based on the size or the dimension, it generally used to take consider a good amount of time. Say if I'm printing something within 3 mm or something in a 3D printer, it's same, similar to what, it just take a fraction of minutes, like 5 to 6, 10 minutes, something like that. It depends purely on the size.
Hardik wants to know, do you think rather than belt, spiral would have worked perfect?
Yeah, that would work perfect, but consider components like the mask or something like that. If it's the 3-ply mask, the user or the people who are stuffing the stuff inside the machine will really feel difficult. And if the thing is, we need to provide a separate provision for it, rather than right now in this machine, anything can be replaced in any of the conveyor belt system, rather than going a fixed one.
Right. And Mihir wants to know, how is the refrigeration? I think it's about cooling. Possibly a vending machine.
So basically, there is no cooling as such that happens inside this machine, since it's going to deal with the basic consumer products like the mask or the general office use items like pen and the stationery items. So I don't require any refrigeration as such into this vending machine. But yeah, when it comes to refrigeration, that's a separate thing that we need to consider, involving multiple components.
How we can give chain drive in mechanical assembly?
Okay, so I don't know exactly whether he wants to provide that idea into this machine. If that is the case, it's like, as I mentioned before, it's an approach towards each person. The approach might vary. If you are giving a chain drive system into this, yeah, it definitely works. But basically, I'm not going to use a roller in a stacked way or a continuous way. If that's my case, and the load that I'm going to carry on top of the conveyor exceeds a limit, then I will definitely go with chain drive system.
So Kundan wants to know, what is the tolerance that is generally used in sheet metal?
So generally, as such, 20 microns is what people would prefer having a tolerance, not only in sheet metal, when it comes to CNC manufacturing as well. It's up to the level of manufacturer and the product that you are manufacturing.
Right. And how much time did you spend to master Fusion 360?
I haven't mastered the Fusion 360 yet. It generally takes quite a bit amount of time, because as I mentioned in my slides as well, things comes in practice. So doing a day-to-day practice, actually I'll reach that stage. By that time, Fusion will come up with some new updates, then I have to learn it again. Things like that will keep happening.
Right. And what glass did you use in the front?
So right now I had used an acrylic sheet, which is a transparent acrylic sheet, which is around 2 mm thickness.
So I think we are on time.
Last question, because it's a 3D print.
This question
is a good one to answer, where somebody was asking the difference between the normal 3D printer and the bio 3D printer, maybe.
Sure.
Is the working of the 3D printer and the bio 3D printer same? And if it is different, then how? So this is Drumil Doshi has asked this question. It's more relevant to what he presented, so I think it can be answered.
Sure. So the thing is, the 3D printers and bioprinters both sounds the same because we are just adding in an text over there calling it as a bio 3D printer. But when it comes to the process and the applications, it's a sort of, what do you say, high-end purpose. Say we can't, the 3D bioprinter should have a certain level of sterility in it in order to print direct human cells or human tissues or skins. So things like that, we need to maintain it under sterility. Generally, our 3D printers will be kept in an open space, even in a table or a kitchen or things like that, where there's a high chances of contamination. So coming into that aspect, yeah, it's it varies. But when coming back to the basic working concept, both remain same.
Fantastic. Thank you, Sarvan. Yeah. I think Varun, you may.
Well, adding to this, so we have Sarvana's details, right? So anybody who wants to get in touch with Sarvana, he's pretty active on LinkedIn and Instagram. So just feel free to reach out to him. And this is not the end. First, I would like to thank Sarvana. Thanks for giving your time.
Thank you, Varun, and as well as the Autodesk for giving me this opportunity as well. And also, I would like to use this medium to represent three entities, like the Autodesk and the Next Big Innovation Labs, and EC3 India for giving me an stage, you know, to perform and explore my opportunities. So things like that. Thanks to everyone. Particularly thanks to you, Varun, for all this.
It was a pleasure having you with us, Sarvana. Thank you so much. And adding to that, something that I want to also showcase, right? So guys, 4 or 5 years back, I was completely into drone designing. I used to make drones. It started from the hobby. And then I started making drones because I was also into rapid prototyping and 3D printing. So I used to design my frames and then I used to fabricate that. So I made this drone and it was back in 2016, I think, right? If I remember. And then I posted that in 2017. So in this image, if you see, the left one is the render and the right one is the actual image. If you can carefully observe, there's a black line in between. Thing ID is mentioned 2453393. I published this design on Thingiverse. That's the final render. People all together from different parts of the world, and they started modifying in the frame itself. So you see these suspensions, these amazing prop savers and all those things. And we got all this. Once again, thank you so much. Thank you, Anand, for being with us, for supporting everybody in the Q&A. And thanks, Sarvana, again. And thanks, everybody who participated. Thank you so much. I'll see you tomorrow. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.